Hey everyone, April Dunham here. In today's video, I want to talk about choosing a data source for your Power Apps applications. I'll explain how Power Apps connects to data, the different types of data sources, and we'll do a comparison of the main data sources and which one to use when. All of that coming up right after this. Let's start with how Power Apps accesses data. This is done through something called connectors. These connectors provide a way for the Power Platform to communicate with different data sources or services. And there are many different types of connectors that are important to understand. For one, we have connectors to what we call third-party services. These would be non-Microsoft services to things like Salesforce, DocuSign, ServiceNow, Twitter, the list goes on. And of course, there are connectors for Microsoft services and data sources. These would be things like SharePoint, SQL Server, Azure, Excel, Outlook. We also have data connectors for what we call on-premises data. On-premises means that the data is stored on a physical server somewhere. So some typical on-prem data that we would connect to would be, say, SharePoint 2016, 2019 on-prem, and SQL Server. The ability to connect to these on-prem services are done via something called the on-prem data gateway, which is something you can install on your computer, which allows that connection between Power Platform and the on-prem data. And finally, we can have connectors to custom or private APIs. So say you have a system that's specific to your company. If that system has an API, we can create what's called a custom connector to that system so that Power Apps and the Power Platform can connect to it. These could be APIs hosted in Azure API Management, and these could even be public APIs that don't currently have a connector, say like Spotify or NASA. And right now with the Power Platform, there are actually over 400 different connectors that we can utilize to connect to data in our Power Apps. Now that we understand how the Power Platform and Power Apps connects to data, let's break down the different types of data sources that we have. The two main data sources we have are either tabular or action-based data sources. When we talk about tabular data, what we're meaning is that data source allows you to store your data in a structured tabular format. Examples of this would be SharePoint. We have SharePoint list that we can store data in a tabular format. SQL Server, we have tables for that. Excel, that's probably the easiest and most universal example to think of. All of those are tabular data sources. There are many benefits to these tabular data sources, especially when you're building applications and Power Apps. For one, it's really easy to surface up that data in galleries or forms. We can directly bind the galleries or the forms that we have in Power Apps to those tabular data sources and get going with those really fast. Another thing you might have noticed if you went to make.powerapps.com is we also have quick starts to these different tabular data sources. So as we're seeing here in the make.powerapps.com portal, we have this option that says start from data. These data sources that we're seeing here, SharePoint, Excel Online, SQL Server, and Common Data Service, which is now known as Dataverse, are all tabular data sources. So with these data sources, we can actually have Power Apps build a completely functioning app for us based off of the different tabular data stored in one of these data sources. So taking SharePoint as an example, we can choose the SharePoint option in the Start from Data. It will take us to a screen where we can find the SharePoint site that contains the list or library that we want to connect to in our Power App. So I'll choose this HR site. This will show me a list of the different lists and libraries we have within the SharePoint site. So if I wanted to create an application for timesheets, I could choose this timesheets list and click connect. And this will build a three-screen application of Power Apps for me that will give me a way to not only view the data that's in that list, but add and edit the data. So as you can see here in the editor, what it did is it created a browse screen that has a gallery in it. And a gallery is a way for us to surface up information from a data source. So what it did is it bound this gallery to our timesheets list in SharePoint automatically so they can see all the entries. And it created a detail in an edit screen. If I expand out the edit screen, you see that we have a form control on here. And that form control is also bound to that timesheets list, that tabular data in SharePoint, so that we can easily have all the different columns that are in that list to allow us to input data. So if I go back to the browse screen and I hit the play button to run the application as if I was using this, you can see that Because this is using a tabular data source and I use the start from data, I'm able to not only browse the information, I can click on one of these timesheet entries, see all the details here. I can go back and I can even click this plus button and add a new entry. This is all done utilizing SharePoint, a tabular data source, thanks to that start from data option. Now, the other category of data sources that we have are what's called action-based. These differ from tabular data because rather than connecting to a list or a table of data, we interact with this data source through different functions or actions. For these action-based data sources, there's not going to be that automatic connection with the galleries and forms like we just looked at, and there's not going to be a start from data option. So what are some examples of this? We have different connectors for Office 365 users, Outlook, and Teams. Now, all of those, we wouldn't actually be storing data in any of those services, but we might want to get data or perform an action on that data. So jumping back over to the sample app that we just started, how would we use one of these action-based data sources? So what we'll do is we'll go over here to the left-hand side and we'll click on our data tab so that we can add in a new data source into this Power App. We'll select the add data option and let's do a search for that Office 365 users connector. So we'll select that and we'll add that here into our app. And this is one of those action-based data sources that we can connect to. And this will query your Office 365 users directory and allow you to return information for a user. For something like a timesheet, you might need to get your manager's approval for the timesheet. That's an action we can perform with this action-based data source, the Office 365 users. So what I'm gonna do is we'll just add a label here on the screen. So I'm gonna reduce this gallery a bit. I'm gonna go to Insert, Text, and Label. And we will store the manager information right here in this label. So I'm going to go to its text property and we'll erase what's in there. And let's just start typing Office 365. And you notice when we do that, we have this IntelliSense pop up. And this is showing us all the different actions that we can take with this particular connector. And if I scroll through this list, one of the first ones that you'll see here is Office 365 users.manager. So if I select that, I can see that this is expecting me to pass it in an email ID of the person I want to retrieve the manager for. And I'll type in the email of who I want to get the manager for. Then we'll do a dot and get the display name of the manager. You can see that as soon as I do that, it updates this label with the name of that person's manager. So that's an example of an action that we performed on this action-based connector. So now hopefully we understand how Power Apps connects to data and the two main categories of data sources we have. Now what I want to do is dive into those tabular data sources specifically. So we know with all those action-based data sources like Office 365 users we just looked at, we can easily perform different actions to retrieve or even write information out to the data source. So going back to that, take the Outlook connector for an example. There's an action to send an email. And for Teams, there's actions to post messages for Teams. So it could be an action to retrieve or an action to actually send or post data to that particular connector. But when we're talking about applications and what data source to choose, typically we're needing to decide where to store net new data. So maybe you need an application to store timesheets and you need to take that data and put it into some kind of system. That's typically done by choosing one of those tabular data sources that we just talked about. So what I'm going to try to do next here is provide some general guidance based off of my own personal experience of the different tabular-based data sources that we can use in Power Apps. And I'm going to break down this guidance and comparison based off of a few different metrics. So we'll cover the licensing involved, the complexity of using the data source, the volume of data that it can store, and the best four use cases. Starting from the top, let's start with Excel, because I've noticed that Excel is probably the most commonly first used data source when starting with Power Apps. And that's for a variety of reasons, probably because most all of us know how to use Excel, so it's the most accessible data source. So obviously in the complexity category, that's going to be very low since a majority of people have used Excel in some form or fashion. Let's talk about the licensing perspective of this. To use Power Apps at all, you need a minimum of a Microsoft 365 license. Now, there are several different licenses that include what's called a seeded version of Power Apps so that you can get started creating Power Apps. Some of those licenses include E1, E3, E5, some of the first line worker SKUs, the business SKUs, and some of the education SKUs. So for Excel, all you need is one of those Microsoft 365 licenses to be able to create a Power App that connects to an Excel spreadsheet. With Excel, when we're talking about data volume, the amount of data that we can store and use with inside our Power Apps in Excel is pretty low. We are limited to a 2 megabyte file limit for Excel itself when using that within Power Apps. In addition to that, we have a row limit of 2,000 rows that we can consume within a Power App. So given that, to me, that's the biggest barrier really to utilizing Excel as a data source for your app. That's really going to limit the scope of what Excel as a data source is good for. It's great for learning. So if you're going through some of those learn modules on docs.microsoft.com and just trying to get a feel for Power Apps, that's a great way to start. Or maybe even some personal productivity scenarios where it's just a small app that only you're going to be using to help catalog and organize your shoes or inventory for items in your house, things like that. Those are okay use cases of Excel as a data source. This is not something that you would want to create an enterprise-wide application on. Moving on to SharePoint Online. SharePoint is another one of those systems that a lot of us are already familiar with. You might be using that for your company intranet. Maybe you upload files to that and interact and collaborate with your colleagues there. So this is another one from a licensing perspective where we only need an applicable Microsoft 365 license to be able to create Power Apps that utilize SharePoint Online as a data source. And when we talk about SharePoint as a data source, this could be either SharePoint List or those libraries. The complexity for SharePoint, I would say, is medium and compared to, say, an Excel. It's a little bit more advanced because there's a few different column types you need to be familiar with and permissions model and little things like that that require some training and getting used to. And for data volume, this one is going to be in the low to medium category. You might not know this, but SharePoint lists themselves can actually hold up to 30 million items. And I know that seems like quite a bit, and you might be wondering, well, why is the data volume low to medium here? There's a few reasons. We have something in Power Apps called delegation. And there are certain functions and formulas that we can do in Power Apps that are delegable and some that aren't. And I'll provide a link in the video notes to some documentation that explains delegation a bit more. But when we're talking about SharePoint here as a data source, once we start getting above 2,000 items in our SharePoint list, there are going to be certain functions that aren't going to be delegable. So that means that all of your data from the list won't be returned in the Power App. A common example of this, going back to that timesheet analogy, if I wanted to return all timesheet records for the current day, if my SharePoint list exceeded 2,000 items, and say if I use the isToday filter to try to return that information, that function would not be delegable. So what it would do is it would only search through the first 2,000 records and return data based off of that. It would ignore the rest of the records. So that's why I say, depending on what you're trying to do here, the data volume is really low to medium for this because there's going to be some situations where you might run into a few delegation issues like that. So with that said, SharePoint as a data source for Power Apps is really good for simple app scenarios, some that don't have a lot of complex permission layers or logic, not a high volume of data for personal applications and maybe departmental applications. Now let's talk about Dataverse for Teams. This is actually a newer data source that we have available to us. Again, also included in that Microsoft 365 licensing. So if you have access to Teams, you will have access to utilize Dataverse for Teams as a data source for your Power App. The data volume for Dataverse for Teams would fall into the medium category. We get 2 gigabytes of data storage per environment, which is a good amount of data that we can store. The complexity, I would say, would be on the low to medium side. When you're using Dataverse for Teams, the interaction with building out your data table is actually fairly similar to a modern SharePoint list. I have some good videos on Dataverse for Teams explaining it a little bit more, but essentially it's a pared down version of Dataverse. So it's going to be a little bit more simple and easier to get onboarded to. One of the things that you need to evaluate when deciding to choose Dataverse for Teams versus some of these other data sources is that you can only use the Power App that you create within Teams itself. So if a requirement of yours is to build a Power App that you would embed in a SharePoint site or something like that, then Dataverse for Teams wouldn't be a good option because you can only use that within inside Microsoft Teams itself. But I really love Dataverse for Teams as a data source because it gives you a truly relational database. And it's very easy to work with. So this would be good for simple to even complex applications and departmental apps. So I'm jumping over here to Microsoft Teams. I'm actually loading up an example of a Dataverse for Teams application. So there's several templates that are provided for you to get started with Dataverse for Teams. So good use cases for this would be some project management system like this milestones app you're seeing. Even things like what we're seeing here with issue reporting, which are typical first line worker type scenarios. So maybe someone out in the field can pull this up, easily report an issue either on their tablet or a mobile device here with this issue reporting Power App built inside of Dataverse for Teams. The other two data sources that I wanted to point out here are Azure SQL and Dataverse. Both of these data sources will require additional licensing. We have two main options right now for Power Apps licensing. We have a per app per user license, which is $10 per application per user per month. And then we have an unlimited or all you can eat, so you say, license that is $40 a user a month, and they can build and use as many different Power Apps as they need with that $40 a user license. So if you're wanting to use either Azure SQL or Dataverse, you will need one of those licenses to do that. From the data volume side, both of those data sources are going to be very high volume. SQL has been around for years. It's used in many different systems. Great relational database that supports high transactional volumes of data. And the same goes for Dataverse. As far as the complexity, I would say SQL would be a little bit more on the high side. There's a lot behind SQL. You need to know stored procedures and views. Dataverse, on the other hand, I would say falls into the medium category. It's much more end-user friendly and easy to get started with. And both of those data sources are going to be good for complex and enterprise-grade applications. One of the things that I did want to point out about Dataverse, though, is it's actually much more than a database. When we start talking about these comparisons of databases, it's easy to bucket Dataverse into that. But I think it's important to point out the distinction where, yes, you are getting a tabular data source for you to store your data, but you're getting much more when you're leveraging Dataverse. We get a rich security and logic layer, so we can integrate things like workflows and business rules. It offers robust data features like data modeling, data validation, reporting, and even mobile offline. And one of the biggest benefits, in my opinion, of Dataverse and choosing that as a data source is the integration possibilities. When we build solutions on top of Dataverse in Power Apps and the Power App platform, we get to take advantage of the solution mechanisms so that we can easily package up and move between different environments and tenants, our data model, and our application layer. We have seamless integration into Azure DevOps, webhooks, data export functionality. We can export directly to Excel and manipulate and use our data there. We have things called data flows to easily pull in data into Dataverse from various systems. So again, all that to say is Dataverse itself is much more than just a database. All right, so I know I just threw a lot of information out at you, but one point that I really want to hit home with here is if you're just getting started with Power Apps, start with what you're familiar with. If you are a SharePoint guru and love your SharePoint list, start there with your application. Don't think that you have to go learn a brand new system just to get started with Power Apps. One of the great things about Power Apps is it's relatively easy to change your data source later on if you need to. Whatever you're comfortable with, go with it. All right, that's all that I have for you today. Do me a favor and hit that subscribe button if you found this video helpful, and I'll catch you in the next video.